I'm a little biased, but I believe this will be the best session that you're going to see in both days. One of the reasons why I think that's the case is that we spend a lot of time at these conferences talking about what should be done, what's a great idea, where I might need something, and then we hope to God, pray to God, that somebody actually does something about it. And what you're seeing here up here will be nine brave souls who have basically said, all right, we've heard you. We think you have a problem. We think you need something done. Here's how we're going to do it. What do you think about it? So what I'd like to do is to give you a little bit of a homework assignment as you're looking at each one of these in three key areas. The innovators need to know, are they solving the right problem? So when you're looking at this, start thinking to yourself, why the heck are they working on this when these are my problems? Because they are listening to the market, they think that the market is asking for these things, and they're presenting a solution. And afterwards, in Back Bay room number one, all the innovators that are up here are going to be up there as well. We'd love for you to come by afterwards and tell them the homework assignment that I'm giving you here is, does what they are innovating on matter to you in your organization, what you've seen in the marketplace, et cetera? Number two, if it does matter, is the technology that they've produced something that you can actually operationalize in your own environment? Because technology that you can't actually get installed, deployed, and running in a large-scale enterprise doesn't really matter. And the third thing is, sometimes what they're saying might ring true in one direction, but there could be another area that something is applicable in where you say, hey, you've solved this problem here, and it looks great. I think you can operationalize it. But you know what? With a small tweak, we'd love to see it used in this other area as well. So remember, this is a give and take. We want the innovators to come out here and tell you what they've done. But the most important part of this is for you to react back and say, looks good, or hey, what the heck are you guys doing? There's a whole other set of areas and other problems that we need to solve. So with that homework assignment, the first presenter I'd like to bring up is Aaron Goldstein. Aaron is going to present to you FeverSmart. FeverSmart is a company that is allowing the measurement of temperatures across the world and from anywhere in the world, focused primarily right now on pediatrics, and he's going to come tell us why that's important, and hopefully you'll give him some advice afterwards.
Great. Good morning, everyone. My name is Aaron Goldstein. I'm one of the co-founders and CEO of FeverSmart. And we built the world's first smart patch thermometer that allows parents to remotely and continuously monitor their children's temperature using their smartphone. So just to get a show of hands, how many people in the audience are parents? It's almost everyone. So you guys know as parents, the most difficult thing that you have to do when your child is sick is wake them up at night to check their temperature. And the reason that you have to get up and then go and wake your children up is because you're using a conventional thermometer. The problem with conventional thermometers are they're difficult to use, they're uncomfortable for children, and most concerning, they only provide a one-time temperature reading. There's no way for you to continuously monitor the temperature and be alerted when the issue starts. So we created FeverSmart. And FeverSmart is consisted of three parts. So there's a reusable smart patch thermometer, so it's a small unit, that adheres to the child's side using a disposable patch. The unit measures something called axillary temperature and sends that data to something called the relay unit, which is an iPhone, iPad, a smart device, which is left in the same room as the child, and that communicates via Bluetooth. From the relay unit, it's then sent to the cloud, so it can be accessed from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. What's interesting about FeverSmart is this flow of technology, so from a vital signs monitoring system to a central relay unit to the cloud to a smartphone is actually patented technology. So this flow of information is patent pending. We think that it can be really influential, not only for temperature and FeverSmart, but for other monitoring systems as well. So you can imagine with the relay system, you could do EKG, SpO2, you could do heart rate and pulse ox. So we think that we're really building a comprehensive platform for vital signs monitoring. But there's actually been some recent changes in the FDA regulations. So about 2, 3, 4 weeks ago, the FDA actually deregulated this class of what they call smart thermometers. So no longer do you need a 510K or a class 2 medical device. As a result, there's been a bunch of sort of entrants into the sensor field. So overseas in the US, there are a lot of companies that are manufacturing the sensor, and you can get a plethora of what they call, you know, these wireless smart thermometers. But great hardware isn't enough, and that we realize that at FeverSmart. So we've spent the past 2 years developing amazing software, because we know that the key to great hardware is this amazing software. So we've been talking to parents, physicians, children. We've been testing and iterating, and we believe that we've really built the most easy to use, intuitive solution, not only for parents and children to use, but also on the clinical side, we have the enterprise system, which will allow one nurse to monitor 10, 50, 100 patients' temperature at once. We could allow the CDC to monitor 5, 10, 100 Ebola patients or aid workers at once using our platform. And some of the amazing features include alert system, so parents can check, can set 101, 102, and when the temperature starts to rise, they can get an alert on their phone. When you turn the phone sideways, you can see the trends over time. So you can see, is the temperature increasing? Has it been decreasing over the past couple hours, days? Which is great for, you know, the 21 days for Ebola patients have to be separated. And also, we're allowing parents to calculate the right dosage of Tylenol or ibuprofen so that they can give their child the right amount. And that's indicated in the app. So there's a countdown, so you can check, okay, it's been the right 6 hours, it's been 4 hours, I can now give them the same dosage, the correct dosage again. So what's the progress to date? As of yesterday, we actually closed our Indiegogo campaign. We initially had a $40,000 goal, which we blew past in the first week, and we ended up with just under $63,000 worth of sales. So the device is finalized, the software is ready to go, and we're really excited to ship the first units come December, January time. But we feel that FeverSmart and our platform, our comprehensive vital signs monitoring system platform, can be helpful to more people than just parents. We think there's a plethora of applications. For example, women who want to get pregnant to track their ovulation, they could use FeverSmart to monitor the basal temperature and the increases and decreases in basal temperature. Ebola patients, so not only those patients that have already been diagnosed with Ebola that need their temperature monitored remotely, but in addition, the aid workers, the news journalists that are at risk, that are currently taking their temperature 5, 10, 15 times a day, they could use their smartphone and FeverSmart to continuously monitor their own temperature. And lastly, we think it would be a great product for postoperative patients. So after your surgery, you could get sent home for with the FeverSmart device. If you'd like to learn more, please come talk to us. I'm here, and my whole team is, booth 102. We'd love to talk about FeverSmart and how we can integrate it into your platforms. So please stop by booth 102. Thank you, and have a great day.
All right. That was great. Thanks, Aaron. So again, if you think about your homework assignments, what you can say is, as a individual kind of diagnostic device, how valuable would it be? How could you potentially operationalize it? And what other areas do you think that maybe Aaron and company haven't thought about that might be of more use to you? Again, back bay room number one, you guys can meet with them afterwards. Up next is a great young company, Jeff Erden is going to talk to us about SWYME, which is focused on the next generation of telemedicine requirements, which are, of course, going to concentrate on video and audio-based collaboration. So he's going to talk to you a little bit about SWYME, and then I'd love to hear your homework assignment afterwards as well. Go ahead, Jeff.
Good morning. Thank you all for braving the elements. I'd like to show you a brief video of our system in action, and I've got a question for you and a goal to send you off with. So let's roll the video to start.
Good afternoon. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. I am here with a 65-year-old female.
Social history, smoking, drinking?
No drinking.
Dr. Stavros, how are you?
I'm doing good. Pretty good.
Excellent. Okay, I understand you've been having some back pain and a little bit of a rash.
Right.
Well, how long have you been having that back pain? Okay, nice. Okay, let's look at the other ear. All right, well, we're going to take a quick listen to your heart and your lungs, okay? Excellent. Let's go ahead and listen to her back of her lungs there. Yeah, think we have a diagnosis for you. It looks like you have shingles. And so we'll have you follow up with your doctor for that, but we can definitely save you a trip to the emergency department. We can start therapy with you today, and then we'll follow up with you tomorrow to make sure that you're feeling better. And then we'll have you follow up with your primary doctor in about a week to see how things are going. We'll make a copy of all this information. We'll send that to your doctor as well.
Seen or done virtual visits before. So the question I have for you is, what's different, what's innovative about this technology? We've made a lot of minivations, things that make it easier to go out into the woods. But really the big thing is changing the paradigm to, we're trying to keep people from having the admission, having the ride to the hospital, dislocating their lives. And if we can transport a doctor into the woods in a click, imagine what we can do within the four walls or within a campus where there's good bandwidth. Our current clients are using us for a variety of goals. I can talk to you about those offline if people are interested. But I'd like to leave you with really two thoughts. The first one is that if you're using a lightweight, easy to use, easy to manage system, it can become a self-funding entity. The reimbursement is going to come along someday, maybe sooner, maybe later, but this can be done today. The other thing is a goal, which I'm trying to get back to. One slide, there we go, 35%. And we've heard 35% increase in revenue, we've heard 35% decrease in readmissions, we've heard 35% patient satisfaction enhancement, cost avoidance. It changes based on the development and the description of the program. But at the end of the day, this is a number that's real and it's out there. Now, I picked it a little bit at random, but it's not made of pixie dust. The challenge to you is to find it in your organization and realize it. And we'd love to help if we can.
Yep. So Jeff said something compelling, which is reimbursement doesn't matter. How many of you buy that argument? Great to have a conversation with him, right? Because he's got some proof as to why it shouldn't matter. Definitely catch up with him afterwards and see why that's the case. Up next on the left-hand side here, on my left-hand side here, we have Aaron. Aaron's going to talk about a teletherapy application called Timocco. And it's actually very cool because it's designed to help solve those problems where a lot of times kids come in and they get a particular diagnosis or they get a particular treatment plan. But then keeping kids engaged in that treatment plan, engaged in that therapy, is really, really hard. So teletherapy is an area that Aaron's going to tell us a little bit more about. Go ahead, Aaron.
Thank you very much, Shahid. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to take this amazing opportunity and share Timocco's dream with you. We wake up every morning at Timocco with a mission to change the lives of 6.5 million children in the US alone. Kids that have cognitive, motor, and communication challenges. You see, when I was a child, it took me 15 years to understand that I could be a winner. If I was born today, I was probably assessed as a dyslexic ADHD child. But if I had games like Timocco during my childhood, I would probably have been able to meet my challenges and win the game a lot sooner. Timocco is a child teletherapy gaming environment that motivates kids on the autistic spectrum, kids with ADHD, dyspraxia, hypotonia, and a variety of developmental delays to rise to the daily challenges and win the game. Step by step, game by game, challenge by challenge, in a fun and interactive way. Since Timocco's inception about 4 years ago, Our professional team has built more than 50 great motion-based developmental games. We developed our own proprietary tracking technology that tracks every red, blue, and green object using a simple 2D webcam on any PC. That's good because that if you work with a special needs child, you understand that Kinect and Wii are not good enough for the task at hand. Let's have a brief look at the video. Can you run the video, please? So you see that Tom here neglects to use his left arm. Tom has cerebral palsy. In our platform, he uses our Glavi balls to pop the blinking balloon on screen. He progresses from one game to another according to his specific needs, his range of motion, his reaction time, his cognitive level. It's amazing to see that now he can use both of his arms to pop the balloons and the bubbles on the screen. Once the Tom understands what he needs to do to win, we can remove the blue glove from his right arm. And it's amazing to see how well he can succeed using his left arm only. That is his personal win. That is our role, to raise motivation so he will be able to do the task he needs to do. We have more than 5,000 kids already using our platform. Therapists from the US and elsewhere enroll in our platform every day. But the most amazing thing about Timocco is that those kids are so motivated to play that they are practicing at home between sessions. That could be done according to a weekly plan that the therapist designs for the child. Here you can see how the weekly plan looks. The therapist then can track the results, the child's reaction time, range of motion, path of motion, trajectories, over time, from anywhere. Timocco creates a win-win-win situation for the child, the parent, and the therapist. But it's also a win for the health service provider, who can benefit from cost reduction and create new revenue stream based on services delivered using our platform. We understand that if we want to fulfill a global dream, we need to be located here in the US. To continue and support our existing ties with partners we have in the US, and I'm here to meet new partners and investors to support us in our mission. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, can we switch to the second computer? Thanks. I want to invite you all to raise your arms and join Timocco and me while we're playing. I'm controlling Timoko's hands now. This may not be an issue for me or any one of us here in the crowd, but for 6.5 million kids in the US alone, this skill is critical. Thank you very much. It's critical for their success. I invite you to join us in our mission to empower each and every one of them. Thank you very much.
That was just terrific. So you can see telemedicine in one respect for diagnoses, et cetera, is a great area. But teletherapy, come talk to him about what you think about teletherapy, how it might be useful in your organization going forward as well. Up next, I'm not sure this is a good way to start this off, but Dr. Lukovic here from is going to talk about from your company name, I'm sorry, I forgot.
That's SunSprite or GoodLux.
Yeah,
Technology.
SunSprite. Yes. So GoodLux. It was misspelled on the card. So GoodLux, so he's a big Steelers fan in Patriots territory. So I'm not sure that was a good way of starting up, but it's a good way to having an interaction here. So he's got a PhD in applied physics from Harvard, focusing on light as it connected to semiconductors, but then use that great information to apply it towards healthcare. And so a lot of what we see in our healthcare environment today and dealing with patients is focused on their lack of understanding how sunlight affects them. And this was great because when I first saw this, I thought it was going to be a terrific presentation on that particular subject. Go for it, Ed.
Thank you. I have a good college friend who moved from sunny Denver to, let's face it, dreary Boston. She developed depression and went on medication. She gained 30 pounds in 6 weeks and was so sedated that she cannot remember trips that we took together or time that we spent together. I know that we can do better than this, and today I'm going to show you how. My friend's example is just one of the ways in which our relationship with the sun is killing us. Most of you are probably aware of the dangers of too much sun exposure, sunburn, and skin cancer. But equally dangerous is not getting enough. It leads to disrupted circadian rhythms, which causes poor energy in the morning and insomnia at night. It leads to vitamin D deficiency. And very importantly, it actually leads to clinical depression. 100 million Americans will suffer symptoms of the winter blues this year. And of those, 30 million of which will be actually clinically depressed. Looking at these statistics led us to ask ourselves the question, are we getting enough light? And we found we didn't know the answer. So we invented Sunsprite. Sunsprite is like a Fitbit for light, and it does two things really well. First, it tracks the amount of bright light and UV exposure that you get throughout the day. And the second is it has a companion mobile application that takes these decades of medical research and combines them in a way that's easy for the user to understand. So let's take a look at the device itself. We took the best things from wearables and combined it into Sunsprite. The first thing is it attaches via a flexible magnetic clasp, so you can wear it in the way that's right for you. Clip it on your shirt, purse strap, it goes through a thick winter jacket, however is best for your condition. The second thing, and what we're really, really proud about, is it's completely solar powered. There's no need to charge it, no cords, no cables, no ports. Just a few minutes of bright light each week is enough to keep it going forever. And third, it's very simple to operate. There's a single button on the side, and you press it, which causes a series of LEDs to light up. There's 10 in total. So if you get 4 out of 10, you know you're 40% of the way to your goal. If the next LED is blinking, then you know that you're in light that's bright enough to be beneficial to your health. Now I'd like to switch over to show you guys the iPhone app that goes with this. And can you see it? Okay, great. So on the home screen, the first thing you'll see is a big glowing sun that shows your progress towards your goal. Directly below that, you'll see the number of minutes to go you need in the particular light that you're in, as well as the current intensity of light. If you're worried about UV exposure, we show that in the upper right-hand corner in an easy-to-use interface. The app allows you to set your own ideal sleep and wake times, and that sets your personal light profile. You can see on the bottom here, there's areas coded in green, which are good places for me to get my light, and areas in red, which can affect my sleep schedule. We allow you to see your weekly progress and view it over time, as well as show some current streaks, badges, and awards to keep people engaged. And then back to the slides. So I want to highlight two statistics from the users that we have of our device. We've shipped over 1,000 of these already, and there's two things I want to highlight. First is that 82% of our users reported that they've changed their behavior as to how much light that they get. And the second is that almost 3 in 4 people report an increase in energy, mood, focus, or sleep, our key metrics. So we're doing what wearables dream of. We're changing behavior, and we're changing it in a way that's beneficial and recognizable to the user. So I'd like to leave you all with three things. The first is that we've started several pilots in hospitals, clinics, and with private providers nationwide. So if you're interested in depression and seasonal depression, come talk to me afterwards. You can check us out on sunsprite.com. And if you're interested in getting one for yourself, a special coupon code for you guys is Connected Health, one word, just enter that at checkout. And third, our Twitter handle is @sunsprite. We'd love to hear all your thoughts, questions. We're listening and we'd love to engage with you. Thank you.
All right, that was great, Ed. So how many of you, just show of hands, buy the argument that seasonal depression is or could be caused by sunlight? Well, there you go. You got a bunch of customers. All right, great. Up next, we have a company that is related to a company called FeverSmart. How many remember FeverSmart, the first company to present? Just checking out, making sure you're paying attention. So FeverSmart, as you know, made that little patch. And up next, we have Jared and Rong, who are coming from Raiing Medical. They are one of the partners for FeverSmart to help build those little patches. So a lot of times we think about software, and especially enterprise software, as the most important thing. But somebody's got to build some of those things, and we're going to hear from these guys on how they do it. Great. Welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. We're going to start with a video first. All right, thanks everybody. So we just saw a really cool piece of technology that allows us to capture a child's continuous temperature. So I'm a researcher at Boston Children's, and we were really interested in this because we've done a lot of work around developing fever decision support. And we've developed a framework called Thermia, which is used to educate parents for what to do to treat children when they are sick. So the Author Monitor is a perfect opportunity for us to capture the data that we need for our algorithm. So we heard earlier from FeverSmart about some scenarios where having this information is absolutely crucial. So I've been working closely with Raiing to integrate Thermia into the iThermometer application. So if we could switch back to the other iPhone, please. So this is the, so I'm just gonna show a quick prototype that will explain this integration. This is the home screen of the iThermometer app. And there's a lot of information here, but we're just gonna focus now on the Thermia integration. So as we can see that child had a temperature, we wanna learn more from Thermia. So let me just first start by stating that Thermia does not provide medical advice. Instead, we present established treatment guidelines that are used to treat for children that have evolving symptoms. So let's move on. So Thermia collects information about a child's symptoms, their some brief medical history, as well as an age and weight, and uses all of this to run our algorithm. So let's take a look at the results. So we can see that our child John does indeed have a temperature, and this is shown with some historical context. We see his recent temperature trend. Current common treatment guidelines are shown with doses that are based on the child's current weight. We can also drill down into some of the specific symptoms and learn a little bit more educational information about these symptoms and additional treatment options that might help alleviate any discomfort. So if you can switch back to the slides, please. So the iThermometer app is available to download now. It's going to upgrade in about 2 weeks for free with complete Thermia functionality. So our partnership enabled us to develop a reliable report of fever progression based on the continuous monitoring of both symptoms and temperature. So this information allows parents to have more productive office visits, to decrease medical costs, and to allow researchers like myself to build better biosurveillance systems. So I've been working closely with Raiing to develop a business model based on open access. So we believe that health data should belong to the individual to download and use as they wish with any third-party application. So if you can switch back to the slides one more time, to the iPhone one more time. One example of this is with HealthKit. So we're showing now my partner Raiing is wearing an iThermometer, and we can see her temperature as viewed through the HealthKit application. You can see her current temperature trend, and we can drill down and see all the specific data points that are collected by the device. Okay, and please switch back one more time. Thanks, Raiing. We're also working on building an open API, which will allow access to our decision support framework, and this will allow users and other companies to access our services and use that with any temperature data, regardless of the device that it comes from. So I've shown just a quick few examples of some of our open platform. That's the integration of our device with HealthKit and the integration of our software with Thermia. We really invite any health IT developers to work with us to use our services to build better tools for care providers, for telecom carriers, payers, as well as consumers. So with that, you can come visit us in booth 118. Thank you for your time.
Thanks, Jared. And this was a great example of something that a lot of large enterprises, especially, and that is bringing in APIs and standard technologies they can just connect into. And so you saw as an example that think about how temperature is such a simple unit. It seems such as like a simple unit. But if you look at the full range of other phenotypic kind of data that we need to collect and aggregate, this is a big deal. Up next, we have Connie Mester. She's going to be talking about how a lot of technologies that we've just seen today and many that you'll see in the future are really about discrete capture. I got this data from this person. I've mixed it in with something else. And what she's going to talk a little bit about is what would the world look like if we talked about immersing all of this data and the technology in order to focus on the full well-being of a patient or even if you're not a patient. So I'm looking forward to seeing this, Connie. Go for it.
Thank you. I'm not here to talk about health concerns or economic challenges or patients or doctors. Our team's not just focused on data or cool technology, short-term fixes. We design around human behavior, real life, and people. At Thrive, we are transforming the way people engage to make healthier choices to live happier. We call this approach Health Without Boundaries, and really that's where our story begins. At Thrive, we're a group of anthropologists, strategists, behavioral scientists, designers, and technologists, all with a very singular focus. By breaking boundaries of the traditional siloed healthcare approach, we can make more positive impact and influence change. It's really simple. We use a holistic approach to purposefully and effectively reach millions, one person at a time. Everyone wants healthier people. So traditionally, the focus has been on the physical side, solutions for the masses. When we change that thinking and consider the whole picture, focus on mental well-being, you can actually influence behavior, teach new skills, and impact the physical health with individuals more effectively. That's why at Thrive for Seven, we focus on thoughts, emotions, and behaviors to impact both the mind and the body of the individual. When you consider this connection that's really missed in a lot of places between the mind and the body, individuals have the ability to achieve more balance and complete health. This also allows us to tackle very specific needs such as depression, anxiety, and stress. Today, more than 522 million adults suffer with depression, anxiety, and stress. Women, twice that amount. And so to take the opportunity now and focus on this critical challenge is where we're focused. So, how do we achieve health without boundaries and support women on their journey to effective well-being? Well, we purposefully connect those tools. We were talking about all the data, information, and support and center everything around each individual. The result is a whole health solution where people achieve positive balance along all seven dimensions of well-being. To meet that demand for a solution designed with a person's everyday life in mind, we have created an integrated and holistic platform focused on emotional health and mental well-being. Introducing MEVI. MEVI enables users to develop coping mechanisms and restructure thinking and support them along the way, their path towards a healthy, positive behavior. What makes MEVI different? Well, we move beyond providing information and resources, and we take that next step to actually teach a person how to build skills and how to control their thoughts and how to strengthen those abilities. MEVI is specifically developed to address the unique needs of women and guide them through the step-by-step education process to build practical skills. MEVI is built from evidence-based strategies and has demonstrated clinically significant improvement, along with the rigorous research and development process that we have, which I'd be happy to talk about anybody after. We've listened to personal stories, watched people with their health conditions in the participate in the world around them, and we focus on transforming what those thoughts and behaviors are into a way to help them achieve a better outlook in health.
One of the largest and costliest health epidemics affecting women may surprise you. More than 522 million adults worldwide suffer from depression, anxiety, stress, or some combination of the three. Women experience twice the rate of these mental health disorders as men, regardless of race or ethnic background, and most don't get the help they need until now. MEVI is a new mobile health program focused on turning this trend around. How? By helping women deal with emotions in a positive manner and work toward ongoing improvements in their daily life and relationships. MEVI is based on cognitive behavioral strategies that have demonstrated clinically significant improvements of symptoms of depression, anxiety, and stress. Through step-by-step guidance, real-world practice activities, and goal setting, MEVI helps women develop critical skills for effectively managing mental well-being. MEVI is interactive, engaging, responsive, and available whenever needed. Plus, MEVI is a self-directed program that women are more likely to start and complete. But Mevi doesn't feel like a burden or a chore. It feels like a trusted friend, a friend who's always nearby for encouragement, support, inspiration, and wisdom. For women, Mevi shows the path to self-confidence and feeling better every day. For you, Mevi is an extension of your meaningful care, a way to strengthen patient relationships, and a tool that can increase efficiency to help manage the cost associated with this health epidemic. This is the next generation of support for depression, anxiety, and stress. Learn more about Mevi, how it works, what it looks and feels like for the user, and why it makes sense for you at thrive47.com/Mevi.
Thank you, and we look forward to talking to you guys afterwards. Appreciate it.
All right, thanks, Connie. That was great. And as a parent of a pair of twin daughters who are just 17, I love the idea of innovation specifically tailored towards target segments. So women, you know, having something specifically for women, specifically for men, specifically for younger, older, et cetera, those are all actually great innovative ideas. And as you talk to these guys afterwards, let them know whether that mattered. You know, is it the fact that it would be great to have a specific innovation or a specific technology tailored toward a particular age group or tailored toward a particular disease? A lot of innovators tend to think that they need to create something for everyone, and that the bigger the market, the better that they'll do. But in healthcare, even a tiny, tiny fragment of something is still a $1 billion market. So it's okay to say we're going to target further and further and band them by either specialty or by age groups or by gender, ethnicity, et cetera, race. These are the more specialized they are, I think the more value that we'll get out of them. Up next, we have Michael Ferguson from Ayogo, and he's going to come talk to us a little bit about how do we actually improve outcomes and get better adherence through some of these technologies that we're talking about in order to affect behavior change. How many of you believe that it's really, really easy to do behavior change? Good. All right. So we know it's hard to do it. We think that technology is going to help, but social and other behavior change is really, really hard. So as you're looking at the next couple of innovations, think about that and see whether they'll be able to pull this off. And with that, I'd like to introduce Michael.
Thanks very much. Hey, everybody. So I'll start by apologizing in advance for going very quickly through my slides. I got a lot that I want to say and not very much time. And also, I will apologize for not having an awesome, slick video. Everyone seems to have great videos, and I don't have one. But hopefully, I'm interesting enough for you. So Ayogo is a technology company, yes. But we went back in time and found the earliest innovation, one of the earliest innovations humanity's ever come up with to solve one of our most important contemporary problems, which is this. So this is actually the most important application that a patient is given. Often this one's for a diabetic. You can look at it right away and see that it's not personal. It doesn't say anything to me about myself. It's very difficult to engage. It's not interesting to look at. Your patient will go home and then instead engage with something like this. One of the most trivial applications that they will ever utilize. It's beautiful, it's engaging, it's interesting, and very personal. That is a problem that we can solve. So, what is the source of this problem? The source of this problem is that you have a 200,000-year-old brain, and that your brain is not optimized for our contemporary world, an efficient instant gratification world. It's optimized for a world full of danger, danger and uncertainty. But it's not all bad news, because our ancient brain also evolved this very interesting and unique strategy for acquiring new information and skills. These two children are participating in the most ancient ritual, which is hide and seek, of course. The only really good way to teach a child how to hide from predators and seek prey. It is the gamification of a critical survival skill. Gamification is not putting points, badges, and leaderboards on top of systems that are not fun. That's like welding wheels on a bicycle. It looks like a bicycle, but it is not rideable, and ultimately unsatisfying. And this is really the problem with most gamification approaches today. They focus on the tip of the iceberg and ignore the really important stuff that's below the water, which of course is these five principles. Agency, that is the ability to make real, actual, meaningful choices, real challenges that matter to me personally. Uncertainty, something that we often spend a lot of time trying to get rid of, scrub our medical applications for any sense of uncertainty, critical to engagement, and discoverable rules. If there's, I'm a Canadian, maybe there's other hockey fans in the room, I can give you the rule book for hockey, and nowhere in that rule book will it say anything about going where the puck is going, not where it is. You cannot win at hockey unless you know that rule, and the only way to know that rule is to discover it through the course of play. And this sense of mastery is critical to flow and critical to engagement, and ultimately critical to skill development and behavior change. And then and only then can you get to points and badges, the outcomes, the tip of the iceberg that's above the water. So that's just a little bit of background that I wanted to make sure everybody had before I show you our actual innovation. So this is what we actually do to instantiate those principles, a system that we call Empower, Social Gamified Patient Engagement Solution, designed to create a meta habit of daily engagement through small, meaningful rituals to positively influence the patient's self-concept, how they think about themselves, so that they can then express that new identity in changed behavior. The application, which is an implementation of Empower, is called Picture It, which we have built together with a large US HMO that I'm not allowed to mention until the studies are published. The first step in the use of our application is the patient creates an avatar for themselves. And they do what we call loading. They load the avatar with their goals and aspirations, what it is that they want to accomplish, where they want to be at the end of the program, and they see it every day. This is primarily how they engage with the application. Not talking to a clinician, not talking to some software, but talking to themselves about what it is that they want to do. Every day, they present themselves, their avatar presents them with tasks, five tasks that they complete every day. In completing those tasks, they keep the magnets that hold their avatar's photograph up on the metaphorical fridge. They start successful, and they maintain their success and their trajectory towards their future goal by keeping their magnets on their fridge. And along the way, they unlock stories that are narratives that are intimately related to their therapy. I'll talk in some more detail at the end because that's a really important part of helping the person manage their self-concept. So they get these 3 to 5 daily activities over the course of 12 weeks. There's an initial 12 weeks of engagement and then a maintenance period after where they maintain their habits. In the case of this particular application, which was designed for patients in the bariatric surgery program at a major US HMO. They have daily weigh-ins, exercise goals, protein consumption. This is a pretty complicated program, and they have. Then there's 5 things that they need to do every day. That is presented to them in this DigiDoIt list. And so, unlike many applications which try to have minimal impact on your life, we actually engage with them maximally, multiple times a day, 5 times a day, 6 times, 10 times a day, getting them to engage with the application to build these small rituals of engagement that keep the application interesting. The swiping of a completed activity off the screen gives them a little animation and a small reward. We actually get them to log things manually, not because we need to, but because it's actually important to have them think about what they're doing. Manual logging is important, although we do support a variety of devices. Sorry, I lost my. A variety of devices to track their activity automatically over time. But I'm rushing because I wanted to get to these educational stories. So this is actually a really important piece of the application. These stories are intimately tied to their therapy. The milestones in their therapy unlock these stories, which are choose your own adventure stories, where they walk and make choices for the character in the story. Making, as you've probably all played Choose Your Own Adventure stories, you go and you make all the right choices, and then you go back and make the wrong choices just to see what happens. In exploring this problem space, they're developing for themselves a language that they can use to engage with their clinician, presents them with opportunities that are tied to milestones in their therapy, but they give the clinician the opportunity to introduce these subjects, some of which are very challenging and emotional, issues of the bedroom, issues of the bathroom, issues of the kitchen. And they can explore these at their own pace, in their own way, to help them advance their own understanding of their condition and their therapy. Our results have been very good. In our most recent pilot, we've had users in our experimental group outperform the control group by over 250% measures of weight loss and maintain that weight loss over the course of a year. We're very excited about this result. There's nothing condition specific about our techniques or our platform, but we've had some very good results with obesity. We've also been working with diabetes and some rare conditions as well. I'm happy to talk to you about those and discuss how we might be able to use our platform to help solve the problems of some of your patients. Thank you.
That was great, Michael. Thank you very much. So most of the day today, you guys have seen some very sexy presentations, and those are things just like Ayogo and Mevi and others. But up next, we have Philip Ola talking about from iSTOC, talking about something that's not very sexy, but absolutely necessary, and that is we know that there's a plethora of new diagnostic devices, diagnostic techniques, little kinds of tests and other things that are coming out very regularly. What we don't have is a platform where we can take these arbitrary diagnostic devices, bring them in, and actually do something with that data. Most important is remote diagnostics. You're out in a rural area, you've done a quick test, who's going to now do a read on that test and tell you what's wrong? So I'm really excited to see this because I spend a lot of time on this unsexy world of enterprise software and unsexy world of diagnostic tests, but very, very important. Go ahead, Phil.
Thank you. And I disagree. I think this is really sexy stuff. So, okay, so does anyone know what a rapid diagnostic test is or a lateral flow test? Okay. Has anyone ever used a pregnancy test or seen a pregnancy test? Show of hands? Okay, so lots of, it's the same thing. So these are basically what we call rapid diagnostic tests or lateral flow tests. And what we've done is we've created a mobile platform that allows you to read and digitize the results from these tests. Now, typically, you would say, well, all you're doing is removing the subjectivity of read. But what we've done is something a little bit more than that. We're able not only to decode the yes or no, but depending on the level of the proteins or molecules or infections within the test, we can provide a semi-quantitative result. So we can tell you, for example, with a drug, something called the drug ICOP, it can decode almost 15 different types of drug levels. So within that, we can tell you not only is the drug there, but the different levels of the drugs that are available within that urine. So it's really helping move these things forward. So I'm just gonna give you a quick demo. So I'm gonna actually go into the application. So I'm doing something which is really crazy today. Not only am I trying to demo the app, I'm also gonna try and demo the web platform as well. So when you first get into the app, the first thing that you'll see is the diagnosis received. So this is really a two-way communication between the either the healthcare worker or the consumer who is trying to take the test and the health system. So it allows you to, when you do take the test, it allows you to basically send information back and get a response back based on what kind of treatments, whether you need to retake the test, or whether there's anything in particular that needs to be done. So I will, if I look at that, I will see straight away that these are the tests that have come back and that I need to action them. So in this situation, if I'm a clinician, I would say, yes, the patient's informed, and then we know that there's a close in that loop. What I'm going to do is show you some of the different types of tests that we have. So we have HIV, we have the pregnancy, influenza, prostate cancer, and malaria. Now, these are only the tests that are applicable to me. So if you were healthcare systems and you were looking at community-based drug testing or HIV, you would only see those tests on there. But the key thing is any kind of test that has been built, we can digitize it and send that information back. So I'm just going to scan. I have a malaria test here, so I'll just share the malaria test. Hopefully you can see this. Okay, and then it gives you the option of saying, is the image okay? And it looks exactly like the one there, so I would say yes. And it does provide the results on the screen. So you do get the preliminary results, and then once I've done that, it sends it back to the server. So I'm now going to switch over to the portal and show you what that information looks like on the portal while that's sending. So on the portal, there's a couple of things that, that you'll notice. We have the dashboard view, which is I'm looking at now. And this basically provides information about the test that I've just sent through. So I can just provide some comments saying, Shah is cool. That's our moderator, by the way. No action required because just the test. And I save that, and then it sends that back to the phone, and that will beep in a minute. Some of the other components is this is geotagged. So you're able to look at all the results for a particular type of tests coming back from a region. It also provides you the ability to do inventory control and quality assurance, so you know that the tests that went out, they were used appropriately and for the right purpose. Then the other component, get to the top of this. So some of the other components is the reporting. We're able to provide detailed analytics of any particular kind of test by geographic region, the results per user, and also the distribution of those tests that went out. Now, another quick thing to mention is that this is a very flexible platform, and we've deployed solutions with malaria, dengue fever, we have HIV, and we're now working on a project in China where we're looking at a fertility project. Now, who would have thought that fertility was an issue in China? But it is a billion-dollar market. Our solution is FDA and CE approved, so what we're really looking for is we're looking for some of these innovative problems that you have that we can apply our solution to those problems to create great clinical systems or consumer-focused systems. So I'm going to be around in the Bay Room upstairs, so if you have any ideas of how this can be used, it doesn't matter what the disease state is, as long as there's a test for it, we can digitize that test. So hopefully I can see some of you up there, and you can give me some feedback or some ideas of how we can collaborate. Thank you.
Thanks, Philip. That was great. I mean, I hope some of you recognized how hard it is to do what he just showed, which is use a diagnostic test that could be run by somebody completely untrained, yet get a diagnostic result with some clinical efficacy remotely. I mean, it's just amazing that that they can pull this stuff off with appropriate regulatory approvals as well. Last but not least up is a company called Basis. Jonathan Lee, who heads that team, was part of Basis before Intel purchased them. How many of you have heard about the wearables movement? Right? So you can see it's important. Obviously, that was a joke. Everybody knows the wearables movement is big and hot. And of course, Jonathan will tell us about where Intel is taking us in the next generation.
Thanks. Well, good morning, everybody, and thanks to the organizers for inviting us. Excited to be here in Boston, especially given our research collaborations with MGH and the Boston VA. I want to start by telling you a little bit about Basis. We are an Intel company located in San Francisco. There's 60 of us, and we come from a variety of backgrounds, everything from sensor development to classical ballet. But we have a common goal, which is to create wearables that really make a difference in helping people lead healthy lives. We released our first product, the Basis B1, in holidays of 2012. And our newest product, Basis Peak, is coming out next month. So lots of things I could tell you about Peak, but I'll just share a few things. With Peak, we've created a product that just fits seamlessly into your life. So one of the things that it does is automatically classifies different activities that you're doing. So from walking to running, biking to sleeping, all automatically, no button pushing. Our advanced sleep analysis doesn't just tell you when you're sleeping, but also what stage of sleep you're in. And that's a feature that we developed in collaboration with partners on the screen there. Probably the feature that I'm most excited about is our re-engineered optical heart rate sensor. It gives you continuous 24/7 heart rate from your wrist, even during exercise. The design of Peak is all new. It's got aluminum body construction, Gorilla Glass touchscreen, water resistant up to 5 atmospheres, and battery life up to 4 days. But the real power behind Peak doesn't just come from our design or our sensors, but really how we integrate all that data and create a truly valuable experience for our users. And with that, I want to show a video that shows Peak in action.
Introducing Basis Peak, the ultimate fitness and sleep tracker. In exercise or at rest, Peak's advanced sensors give you readings 24/7. Get a detailed picture of your performance. Peak collects in-depth data on your body all day and seamlessly sends it to our app. Body IQ automatically detects sleeping, running, walking, and biking. Peak tracks REM, light, and deep sleep. It also gives you feedback on sleep duration resting heart rate, and more. A better rest makes for a better you. Even the smallest changes to your routine can help you improve sleep, burn calories, and be more active. Our app makes it easy to track and improve your habits. Every movement, every moment matters.
And with that, I want to invite you to come talk to me afterwards if you're interested in learning more, or drop us a line at myresearch@mybasis.com. All right, thanks.